The French Revolution was a political and social revolution that began in France and lasted from 1789 to 1799, when the people overthrew the monarchy and took control of the government. But what caused the French Revolution to occur in the first place? Hi, I'm Marchelino George. In this video, we're going to learn about the causes of the French Revolution, what happened during it, and what is the legacy of it. To understand what caused the French Revolution, we need to understand what the structure of France was before it all happened. France was an absolute monarchy, meaning it was ruled by a monarch who had total control over the government and the people. It is referred as the Ancien Régime. The Ancien Régime had a feudal system in which the French people were divided into three social classes called estates. The first estate was made up of the clergy, the second estate was made up of the nobles, while the third estate was made up of peasants, merchants, craftsmen, commoners, and pretty much 98% of the French population. There was little chance for people to move from one estate to another. The 18th century also saw a profound intellectual and cultural movement known as the Age of Enlightenment. Philosophers and artists promoted a wide range of new ideas, such as liberty, progress, tolerance, equality, democracy, and separation between church and state. This caused many people to question the king's right to rule and the hierarchical structure of France. In 1754, a war between France and Britain began over disputed territories in North America, which spilled into a global war known as the Seven Years' War, or the French and Indian War in North America, which resulted in the British victory. During the Treaty of Paris of 1763, Spain gave up Florida, while France gave up all its territories in North America to the British. France wasn't heavily in debt because of the war. But it wasn't just France that was in debt, so was Great Britain, and they taxed the hell out of the colonies, which caused them to revolt and declare their independence during the American Revolution. Significantly, they called for a new type of government, called a republic, in which the people ruled rather than a monarch, inspired by the aforementioned Age of Enlightenment. France decided to declare their allegiance with the Americans in 1778 to get revenge for the French and Indian War and to stop the British from growing more powerful. Their support would eventually help them win the American Revolutionary War, which lasted from 1775 and 1783, gaining independence and creating the United States of America. I already have a video about this which you can watch. Don't watch it now, watch it later!
Anyway.
Although it was good news for the Americans, it was bad news for the French, as they were in more debt than ever and later slid into a huge financial crisis. The king at the time, Louis XVI, had borrowed heavily to support his lavish lifestyle. In particular though, the French people grew increasingly disdainful of the queen, Marie Antoinette, as she continued to spend all of France's money on her own luxuries and fashion, which gained her the nickname Madame Deficit. There was also a scandal around the fact that Marie wasn't giving birth to a male heir. Therefore, the working classes of Paris began mocking the royal couple with very inappropriate pamphlets that I cannot talk about on YouTube because I must be family-friendly and school-appropriate as possible. With such great debt, the king had no other choice than to raise taxes. The third estate had to pay most of the taxes. What's more baffling was that the first two estates, who had a lot of money, had to pay little to no taxes, which angered the common people since they had literally no money to pay these taxes. France was also experiencing famine. The people from the third estate mostly ate bread to survive. However, the cost of bread skyrocketed, and the people started to get hungry. According to one popular study, when Mary was asked what the people should do when they had no bread to eat, she replied,
"Let them eat cake!"
Stories like this caused the people to become angry. Once more, the first two estates had massive stockpiles of bread, so they were virtually untouched by this new crisis. However, the poor really were starving, and they began to riot. They raided bakeries and sometimes even lynched bakers suspected of keeping bread for themselves. In response to the crisis, King Louis called a meeting of the States General, the king's advisory body, which had not met since 1614. The States General was made up of representatives from all three estates. One of the first things they were discussing was how they would vote. The king decided that each state would get one vote. Although it might seem fair at first, the third estate was clearly unhappy with this voting system because it meant that any decision they made could be outvoted by the two smaller estates. So since they were 98% of the population, they began to take matters into their own hands. On June 13th, 1789, the third estate declared the National Assembly. King Louis was obviously unhappy with this motion and ordered the building where they were meeting to be closed. However, the National Assembly was not to be denied. They later moved to an indoor tennis court, where on June 20th, 1789, they took the tennis court oath, vowing to continue meeting until France had a constitution. This new National Assembly included many of the most educated members of the Third Estate, including two young lawyers by the names of Maximilian Robespierre and Georges Danton. Some members of the first two estates even joined their cause. Some of these men formed a new radical political party called the Jacobin Club and became leading figures. King Louis was pretty angry with what the National Assembly was doing and responding by sending the French military around Paris to quell the revolutionaries and fire Jacques Necker, his popular finance minister, who had been trying to make reforms himself. The people of Paris, seeing what the military was about to do, decided to arm themselves. So the National Assembly, not a National Constituent Assembly, announced the creation of the National Guard, and many troops from the French military defected over to the revolutionary side. In the early morning of July 14th, 1789, a large crowd took over the Hotel de l'Invalide in Paris, where they were able to get between 29,000 to 32,000 muskets. However, they did not have gunpowder for the new weapons, so they looked towards a prison fortress, which was also a symbol of royal tyranny towering over Paris, the Bastille. Around mid-morning, the crowd gathered around the Bastille and demanded that the man in charge, Governor de Lignay, surrender the prison and hand over the gunpowder. However, he refused and took Mindy's advice by stalling and inviting a few members of the crowd in for negotiations. The crowd, still waiting outside, later became impatient, and in the early afternoon, they managed to get into the courtyard. Once inside the courtyard, they stormed the fortress, taking on the French troops inside. Governor de Lignay eventually surrendered. He, along with three of his officers, were killed by the crowd, with their heads impaled on spikes, and paraded around Paris. July 14th is celebrated today as Bastille Day, very similar to the 4th of July in the United States. It is also called the 14th of July. When the National Constituent Assembly heard about the violence that had taken place, they had two choices. They condemn it and try to continue the revolution through peaceful means, or they accept it. Incidentally, they chose option number two. Some historians believe that this reaction paved the way for the violence and bloodshed that would become the legacy of the French Revolution. This widespread acceptance of violence during the revolution is also mostly credited to the writings of Jean-Paul Marat, a man of science with a horrible skin condition that kept him confined to a bathtub. He began writing a radical newspaper he named L'Amour du Peuple, or The Friend of the People. On August 4th, the National Constituent Assembly abolished the feudal aspects of the Ancien regime, such as privileges for the nobility and unequal taxation. Afterward, on August 26th, the National Constituent Assembly, with help from Thomas Jefferson, who you might remember for writing the Declaration of Independence, adopted the Declaration of Rights of Man and of the Citizen, a phenomenal document that guaranteed liberty and equal rights to everyone. That didn't include women, nor slaves. Despite this, the Declaration would go on to inspire the fight for liberty and equality throughout the world for centuries, something that the French Revolution would do a poor job of doing, but back to our topic. Despite this, most people weren't really concerned with ideas of liberty and equality as much as they were concerned that they were still starving, bread was still expensive, and the people felt that one reason that nothing had been done yet was that the king just couldn't see the problem. The thing is that he lived in Versailles, which is 13 miles or 20 kilometers southwest of Paris, and therefore lived in comfort, separated from his subjects. On the morning of October 5th, 1789, a large group of women in Paris began a revolt. They marched all the way to the king's palace in Versailles. Along the way, the crowd continued to go into the tens of thousands. When they arrived, they demanded to meet the king. Many from the crowd managed to break into the palace, intending to kill the queen, who escaped through a secret passage in her bedroom. The enraged mob killed several members of the royal guard and raised their heads on spikes. Eventually, peace was restored by the Marquis de Lafayette, the leader of the National Guard. Later that day, the king addressed the crowd from a balcony. He agreed to meet the revolutionaries' demands to return to Paris with them. The king and queen then traveled back to Paris with the crowd and went to live at the Tuileries Palace, removing the separation between king and subject. King Louis tried to remain on good terms with the revolutionaries to prove his support for the revolution. On one occasion, a mob would invade the palace and demand he wear the revolutionary bonnet. Seeing the situation rapidly turning against him, the king decided to leave France and mount a campaign to retake his country from abroad. Luckily for him, he was married to an Austrian. So on the night of June 20th, 1791, the king and his family disguised themselves as servants and tried to flee to the Austrian Netherlands, but were recognized at Varennes and promptly returned to Paris. But now, his lack of support for the revolution was clear to all, and many considered him a traitor who tried to abandon his people. As a result, the new constitution of 1791 reduced his powers and made France a constitutional monarchy. However, radicals, such as those in the Jacobin Club, were outraged that the king wasn't to be removed entirely. So on July 17th, these radicals gathered in the Champ de Mars to sign a petition calling for the king's removal. Lafayette sent the National Guard to control the crowd and responded to a barrage of stones by firing into the crowd, killing between 13 and 50 people. The massacres exposed a deep division within the Brotherhood of the Revolution. On one side were the moderates who wanted to keep the king as a figurehead, while on the other, radicals who wanted to see the king deposed. In the wake of the massacre, these radicals received a wave of support. It is important to note that one form of equality the revolution introduced was equality in execution. This meant no more medieval torture methods like drawing, quartering, hanging, drowning, and burning at the stake. They wanted all criminals, regardless of economic status, to receive the same penalty, a quick and painless one. Luckily, a man named Joseph Ignace Guillotine proposed a ruthless beheading machine. He described his new device. The mechanism falls like lightning. The head flies off. The blood spurts. The man no longer exists. The guillotine, also known as the National Razor, made its debut in 1791 as a new form of execution. The writings of Marat and others continued to call for the execution of anyone suspected of working against the revolution. This included members of the clergy and nobility who had previously benefited from the cruel system of inequality that existed before the revolution. In many parts of the countryside, local lords found themselves under attack. As a result, they began fleeing France to other European nations. These nations didn't like what they were seeing because they feared revolutionary ideas may spread to their own lands. The National Constituent Assembly, now the Legislative Assembly, viewed that these nations may decide to attack them. So France declared war on Austria on April 20th, 1792, and immediately got pummeled. To add insult to injury, Austria's ally, Prussia, joined in the fighting. The Prussian Duke of Brunswick issued the Brunswick Manifesto, warning the revolutionaries that if anything happened to the king, he would burn Paris to the ground. The Duke's letter proved to be a massive success, and inspiring the people of Paris to do the exact opposite of what he intended. They were enraged by the threat, and on August 10th, 1792, a mob stormed the Tuileries Palace. King Louis and his family took refuge in the chamber of the Legislative Assembly, where Robespierre and his Jacobins were gaining ever more power. Given the developing situation, the chamber decided to hold a vote, and it was decided to abolish the monarchy entirely. King Louis XVI was now just citizen Louis Capet, and he was sent to a prison cell along with his wife. On September 21st, 1792, the Legislative Assembly, now the National Convention, officially declared the French Republic, and society underwent a massive change. Enlightened ideas of democracy and equality were of course being implemented. However, these ideas became secondary to fear, paranoia, and utter violence. The new republic began to violently remove any symbolism of the old royalist regime. The church also became a prime target. Priests who refused to take an oath to the revolution were deported or arrested. A new state-sponsored, atheistic religion called the Cult of Reason was created as a replacement for the Catholic Church. Notre Dame, along with many other churches, had their relics destroyed and were converted to temples of reason. Even the Christian calendar didn't survive, as a brand new revolutionary calendar was soon introduced, with 1792 as year one. The government of Paris, now under the control of the radical Saint-Nicolas, began rounding up and imprisoning enemies of the revolution like the clergy and aristocracy. As France's foreign enemies continued to close in, Danton made impassionate calls for men to defend the Republic, and tens of thousands of troops left Paris for the front lines. However, in their absence, Paris was left defenseless. As enemy troops arrived in Verdun, the people of Paris feared that their crowded prisons were becoming a breeding ground for a counter-revolutionary conspiracy. Marat believed that the aristocrats would enact their vengeance on the people, and called on the revolutionary citizens to depend upon the prisons. Fearing those that they already imprisoned, mobs broke into Paris' prisons, and aristocrats, priests, and others were tried and executed on the spot. Even women and children were spared. Between 1,100 and 1,600 people were killed in what became known as the September Massacres. Word of the massacres spread across Europe. The London Times gave voice to the revolution, saying, "Are these the rights of men? Is this the liberty of human nature?" But there was still one man that Robespierre and his radicals really wanted to see executed, that being King Louis the 16th. Ex-King Louis was put on trial for treason on January 17th, 1783. Obviously, he was found guilty, but his punishment was less certain. Many Marats wanted to simply deport him, but Robespierre insisted the revolution could only live if the king was dead. A vote was held, and by just one vote, King Louis was sentenced to guillotine and was executed 4 days later.
Long live the king.
Back on the war front, France managed to push the enemy back, but then more countries joined the coalition against France and everything deteriorated. As a result, the National Convention introduced a conscription law, with each regional department having to meet a certain quota of men for the army. However, not everyone was happy with this new law. The thing was that although Paris was a breeding ground for revolutionary fervor, some of the regions outside of Paris weren't keen on the revolution. Most people were still conservative, supported the church, and just didn't suffer from that much inequality. So as the revolution turned increasingly violent and anti-Christian, many were outraged. Now they were being conscripted to fight for the new republic they hated. That was it! Counter-revolutionary uprisings occurred in a few regions across France, such as the surrounding the uprising in the northwest and the siege of Toulon. During the latter event, the southern city of Toulon invited the British Navy over in the summer of 1793, and then asked if they would like to stay and occupy the city. Being an important naval base, this was a heavy blow to the Republic, who sent a young captain named Napoleon Bonaparte to help stage a siege of the city. Napoleon recaptured Toulon on December 19, 1793. For his service, he was promoted to the rank of Brigadier General. We'll get back to him in a little bit. However, the most notorious counter-revolution occurred in the Vendée region. Between 1793 and 1796, revolutionary forces clashed with the region's Catholic and Royal armies. The Republic defeated the counter-revolution through brutal atrocities. One infamous example was General Jean-Baptiste Carrier, who in one instance had 1,000 civilians, priests, women and children tied to ships, which were then sunk. Kerry would later be found guilty of war crimes and executed. Back in Paris, the moderates still dominated the government. Marat began calling for the moderates in the government to be executed. In turn, the moderates called for the arrest of Marat. This led to a chain of events with the two sides in heated conflict. Robespierre declared the Jacobins to be an insurrection and called the people to arm themselves. On May 31st, 1793, the National Convention was surrounded by radical sans-culottes, and 29 Girondin politicians were arrested. From this moment on, the moderates ceased to be a political force, with Robespierre and his radicals being in almost total control of the government. And this brings us to a woman named Charlotte Corday. Charlotte lived in the northwest city of Caen, and like many in the era, was horrified at the radicalization and increasing violence of the revolution, and the man she blamed was Jean-Paul Marat. She wanted to bring peace back to France, and so she decided to do something drastic. She traveled to Paris on July 13, 1783, and told Marat that she had a list of enemies for him to publish in his paper. Marat eagerly invited her for a meeting, and asked for the list, promising that the traitors would be guillotined the next day. Charlotte then pulled out a knife from her corset and stabbed him in the chest, and just like that, Marat was no more. Charlotte was quickly arrested and sent to the guillotine. Her dream of restoring peace, however, died with her. Marat became a martyr. In temples of reason, symbols of the dead Marat became the new crucifix. In death, he even became a more powerful inspiration for the extreme levels of violence that were about to erupt throughout the new republic. Here comes the Reign of Terror! The Jacobins, now in control, believed that not only was France surrounded by foreign enemies, but internal ones as well. In March 1793, Robespierre and his Jacobins established the ironically named Committee of Public Safety, which had 12 members. Its purpose was to protect the French Republic from its enemies, and essentially became a collective dictatorship, with Robespierre as its leading voice. The Revolutionary Tribunal was also established to try suspected enemies and deliver them their death sentences. With these two new institutions, Robespierre wanted to intimidate France's enemies, and in 1793 declared that terror would be the order of the day. From this point on, we enter a violent period of political repression known as the Reign of Terror. Secret police were everywhere and watched the people closely. France's public had to be very careful what they said and how they behaved. Obviously, criticizing this new system, or the government as a whole, would have you sent to the guillotine. But that's not all. Even the most minor crimes may have you sent to the guillotine, like using Monsieur or Madame instead of the new form of address, citizen, expressing sympathy for the deposed monarchy, or even complaining about the high price of bread, which is ironic since it was high bread prices that caused the French Revolution. Sometimes people even accused those they didn't like without any evidence. Around 17,000 people were executed for suspected crimes against liberty, including 639 in Paris. The most prominent victim of the Reign of Terror was Marie Antoinette, who was finally tried and found guilty of treason in 1793. She expected to be brought to the guillotine in the royal carriage, like her husband, but instead, the Republic provided her a wooden cart. At 37 years old, Marie Antoinette, the most hated woman in French history, was executed on October 16th, 1793. As time went on, Robespierre was hellbent on creating a republic of virtue, which meant increasing the bloodshed even more. Between March and July of 1794, executions in Paris greatly increased from 5 to 26 a day during a period known as the Great Terror. Even those closest to Robespierre would find themselves guillotined if they dared oppose his ideas and actions. At one point, the law of 22 Pere Real ironically denied the right to a public trial for enemies of the people. Outside of France, however, the French army were actually having great success despite a large coalition of nations fighting against them, defeating the Allies at the Battle of Fleurus. On July 26, 1794, or the 8th of Thermidor, year 2, Robespierre made a speech to the National Convention in which he announced he had a new list of enemies to be sent to the guillotine, but he wouldn't give the list. Therefore, everyone was afraid they might be on the list, so when Robespierre came back the next day to give the list, he was arrested before he could speak, and he himself was executed on July 28th, ending the Reign of Terror. But we're not done yet, because we still have more to talk about. So after the fall of Robespierre, a more moderate political group called the Thermidorians took control. They wanted to bring some stability back to France. Radicals such as the Jacobins and Sans-Culottes, who had fueled Robespierre's Reign of Terror, themselves became targets of political repression during a period known as the White Terror. In 1795, the Thermidorians drafted the Constitution of the Year 3 in September, which prevented powers from falling into a single individual again, and created a new government called the Directory in November. While all of this was happening, royalists staged an insurrection in Paris on October 5th, 1795, or the 13th of Vendemiaire, year 4, seeing this moment as an opportunity to bring back the monarchy. Luckily, Napoleon was in Paris at the time, and he took control of the situation by firing into the crowd and putting down the insurrection. For his actions, Napoleon became a general, and was sent to take control of the French armies in Italy. In 1795, France took over the Netherlands, where they set up a puppet state. Then they negotiated both Prussia and Spain out of the war. In 1796, the French planned a three-pronged attack to march on Vienna and knock Austria out of the war. The two northern armies were defeated and forced to retreat. However, Napoleon in the south, with groundbreaking military strategies, managed to push the Austrians out of Italy and began closing in on Vienna. The Austrians freaked out, and Napoleon oversaw the signing of a peace treaty. He had single-handedly knocked Austria out of the war. Meanwhile, the Directory was faced with many problems and remained an ineffective government. It was plagued with corruption and struggled to keep the economy afloat, and because of that, wasn't very popular. Napoleon became a famed hero among the French people, but the extremely unpopular government was concerned that he might get power-hungry ideas. So they sent him off to Egypt, where he discovered a bunch of ancient Egyptian stuff, but then naval commander Lord Nelson destroyed Napoleon's fleet. Napoleon managed to make his way back to Paris, and found himself to be extremely popular, and the government extremely unpopular, and he started to get power-hungry ideas. On November 9th, 1799, Napoleon and his allies overthrew the Directory and created a new government called the Consulate, which essentially made Napoleon dictator of France, marking the end of the French Revolution. So there you have it, the entire French Revolution explained in exactly 25 minutes. The common people led a bloody revolution to overthrow an oppressive system that had existed for centuries, reordering French society that respected liberty and equal rights for all citizens. However, groups of revolutionaries would battle each other for power, with Robespierre and his radicals utilizing a bloody repressive system to ensure the revolution's success. The French Revolution sought to prevent one man from having absolute power, but it had effectively swapped one for another. Despite this, it tore apart the old feudal fabric of Europe and changed the course of Western civilization and the rest of world history forever. Demonstrating the people's ability to overthrow oppressive regimes, the French experiments with democracy inspired revolutions in Russia, Vietnam, China, Latin America, and beyond, leading to the establishment of numerous democracies throughout the world. Wherever tyranny takes place, the cry for liberty, equality, and fraternity is internal. Napoleon, on the other hand, began stabilizing French society. He restored the Catholic Church and got rid of that crazy calendar, among other things, but he remained ever ambitious. He later assumed the imperial title, being crowned Emperor of France. Napoleon's expansionist ambitions, coupled with the ongoing conflict in Europe, would eventually lead the continent into a series of conflicts known as the Napoleonic Wars, but that's a story for another time. Thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, give this video a like or a dislike if you didn't, and subscribe to see more videos like this in the future, and I hope to see you soon.